So now I leave the floor to Bruno Surace, my colleague, who is a PhD in semiotics and media at the University of Turin and a postdoc research fellow at Facets. He's also an adjunct professor in semiotics and cinema and audiovisual communication at the University of Turin and a lecturer at the Collegio Interuniversitario Renato Einaudi. He's the author of two monographs on cinema studies, which I translate the title just for you, The Faces in Childhood in Audiovisual Cultures, Cinema Images and New Media, and Imprinted Destiny for a Theory of Destinality in Cinema. We don't know if the translation is okay, but it could be fine. And he also is a co-editor of many volumes in semiotics and audiovisual cultures. And he's today presenting to us a communication titled Midjourney, Stable Diffusion, and the Theoretical Problem of Imagination.
Thank you. Is the microphone on? I don't have to. Ah, okay, that one. Okay. So I'm a boomer, of course, so I didn't know it was a microphone. Well, thank you. Thank you very much, Christina. Thank you to all the organizers. I'm very happy to be here. The title is, as Christina said, Text to Face and Dalí, Midjourney, and etc., etc. Unfortunately for me, many things I wanted to say have been spoiled this morning, so please believe me, this is not plagiarism. I'd like to interpret it as a common direction of our minds to a common horizon. Both the images you see there have been made by me. So I was the one who wrote the textual prompt, which with this strange acrosis became that images, robotic subjects seen from Madrid, was something like that, the prompt. But if you want to see something else, this one has been made by Dalí, the face of a young researcher, male, with glasses, beard, writing a conference, hyper-realistic. In some way, one of them should be a form of self-portrait, I suppose. At least when I wrote the prompt, I was thinking of me. Maybe the last one, it's a bit fat. I didn't write fat because it was a problem for me. So I selected the traits, the pertinent traits, in order to describe myself. And the first question I would like to do now is, may we consider these self-portraits of me? In some way, maybe we can, because when a painter or a photographer creates her or his own self-portrait, select the pertinent traits. But is it enough to define these new kind of images, form of coherent description of myself, of my face? I don't know, it's a question. I don't have answer for you. I think this is the moment to discuss the theme. Also because another hypothesis is that we are in an anthropologic era in which we very fast naturalize certain words. I said that I did these images with Dalí. Dalí is famous from this summer, so it's a very new software, and we are completely confident with this word and the processes behind, the semiotic processes we are behind this word, or at least we think we are confident. So I'm describing in a very rhapsodic and chaotic way the context. The context, again, that image is an astronaut riding a horse made with Midjourney this time. Rapid diffusion of a new player in the production of creative content, which is artificial intelligence in the wider meaning of the word, with, I think, a specific and face-oriented sectoralization. We can deal with desectoralization looking at deepfake technologies. Again, deepfake, another word we naturalized as a common word, well, it's recent too. Technologies like FaceApp, and more recently, all the so-called filters on TikTok based on changing often deeply changing our resemblance. So I will show you some examples in the slide after this one. All the software based on GPT-3, and we are waiting for GPT-4 technologies. We are referring to autoregressive language models that produce text and conversations close to human ones. Again, we will see an example. Hyper-specialized technologies such as LeapGun. LeapGun is a software based on a gun which is capable to solve the problem of dubbing, because one of the problems of dubbing is that there is no correspondence between what the voice says and the movement of the lips. And this technology is capable to put together these two things and to create a perfect dubbing in every language. And of course, technologies, more specifically text to image or text to face, if we want to into the face domain, DALL-E, Journey, Stable Diffusion, and so on and so forth. Another questions I want question, I give you some questions so you cannot give this question to me later. Do we need to reshape our aesthetic and ethical horizons in order to frame this new era? So must we consider this an anthropological leap, or we have enough tools, enough analytical and semiotic tools in order to handle this new domain? I don't know. Okay. Some examples from TikTok I'd like to say filters like this, because we have a semantic of the word filter, of course, but many of these applications are not anymore filter in the stricto sense of the term. They completely substitute our face. I just showed, they're funny, of course, because they're from TikTok. Unfortunately, there is the problem with my microphone, so I cannot put the audio. Anyway, look at them, no problem. This is a girl who tries to eat the tarallo. Tarallo is, ask Massimo Leone what tarallo is, he will answer to you.
It's a bit,
yeah. Without activating the filter. So the filter activates itself when you open your mouth. So the challenge is to eat the tarallo before activating it. Unfortunately, it's a bit, there's a bit a bad refresh rate. Anyway, you can see the filter, of course, which gives you the best ratio for your face. So based on a kind of aesthetic presumption of the perfect ratio. I go on. A typical face swap filter. This one is quite interesting. You center your face and you can transform into whatever you want by putting it into the text box. So he wrote Ryan Gosling, and that's the result. This is very interesting. The manga AI filter capable of transforming you, your face, or also, you know, the muzzle of your pet into a manga. Cute, of course. And one of my favorite, this one. It's very bad because we lose. Anyway, she asked her grandma to come to see the filter, and she falls down. Probably because there's something perspectual, there's something perspective happening. So you are not so far from the inactive perspective we talked about this morning. But go back a little bit. So go back to the generation of artificial face through different artificial intelligence. Professor Pinotti already mentioned that this person does not exist, already said that there is a phenomenological problem because we are dealing with a loss of the indexicality, usually and maybe rhetorically referred to photographs. The problem is multiple, first of all, because we're dealing with images with a specific substance of expression. They seem photographs. So we look at them, and if we ask to our friends, what are you seeing? Probably the answer will be, this is a photograph, but they are not photographs. They're something different. This is connected semiotically with many problems, of course, with the problem of veridiction by Gray Mass. You know, they are something, but they seem something else. And they give rise to many doubts. The first one is the semiotic one. So if aesthetically they appear perfectly attributable to human faces, is there a semiotic surplus somewhere that we should take into account? If they seem photographs, are they photographs from a semiotic perspective? Should we be interested in the process behind the construction of these images? Of course, there is the phenomenological problem. I also put CF Pinotti, because it was already mentioned, this thing. Do these images of subjects outline new subjects? I think they could think of the catfishing phenomenon before these technologies to do catfish. You had to steal images from other people. Nowadays, you can create your own personal images. And here, there's the cognitive hypothesis, and I will deal with it later. And the aesthetic doubt, where is the creative world? This is more connected with George's presentation. So, the porn slide later. Okay. a cognitive uncanny valley. So here I'm quoting myself. So cognitively, before there is a face that you see, there is a face that you think. And both are imagined face in a different sense. It is not a perceptual fact that creates discomfort looking at these images, because these are, you see, normal people. But maybe could be a cognitive fact. Namely, we know that face in front of us, albeit so realistic, does not correspond to a body, to an entity that is real. So it is not an index, but probably is an icon, or if we want to be Peircean, it's a hypo icon created maybe through indexical origins, because we know there are data sets and so on and so forth. So the knowledge that a face that seems real to us is fake throws us into an uncanny valley, very similar to the one in which we fall when we do not know it, as in the classic cases. There is therefore also a semiotic matrix at the origin of the phenomenon. I'm talking about a retroactive uncanny valley, reconstructed backwards in a form of reverse signification compared to the classic one. Of course, the theme of indexicality and on the loss of indexicality opens to a variety of ethical and also legal issues. This is a real screenshot I made on Pornhub. I was doing research for another paper. So it's a paywall video put before the porn video you want to watch, which advertises a face swap application made through deepfake technology. This is the promise of the advertisement. I don't know if the app works well or not, but this is the semiotic expectation you have looking at this advertisement. This is the theme, I think, close to what Remo is going to tell us in his presentation, so I don't want to steal him many materials. But again, we are entering in an era where the theme of indexicality probably must be rediscussed deeply. Other example is related to the form of anti-aging technologies. Examples in cinema here: two movies shot in the same year, The Irishman by Scorsese and Gemini Man by Ang Lee. Both use this kind of anti-aging technologies. Very complex. It's interesting that both Netflix and the productive company of Gemini Man wanted to let the audience know the technology behind these anti-aging cutters. So the technology itself becomes spectacular in some way. The fact that we can do many things, many new things with faces. But it's interesting from a cognitive perspective, the reaction to this video. These are comments taken from the YouTube videos, the first one related to the Irishman. I read some for you. Mark, I loved this. Sadly, the anti-aging wasn't the best. Even if it was better, you can tell their actual age by looking at their movements throughout the movie. Regardless, still love seeing these actors work with the director again. So, okay, they seem younger, but I see the movement of the face and of the bodies, and I can say they're no younger. Alan, makes them look like they're in a video game. Gianmarco Giuliano, this is for you. I think that it's unbelievable. It looks strange, and they could have done better. Creed didn't work so well, but still a great film. Damo still moved like old people. So, perceptually, working on a face doesn't immediately imply that you are creating a younger version of Robert De Niro and Al Pacino. Something remains, probably also something related to the encyclopedia, the fact that we know that this technique has been used. And I put a little bigger the comment on the center of the screen. Next level, recreate Charlie Chaplin, Marlon Brando on screen. Another team, the team already mentioned by Pinotti, the digital resurrection. So the connection with death that is subtly, surreptitiously promised by this technology. The algorithm, therefore, acts as a sort of puppeteer of what is a photographic corpse, not so much animated, but reanimated. Again, the when there is no quotation is because it's my word. According to a clinical metaphor in which machine learning is the defibrillator. Here, then, we move from the epistemic to the metaphysical, reconfiguring the new technologies in the impossible interstices that exist between the living and the dead, and placing ourselves in the anthropological condition of having to reconstruct the idea of the image of those who are no longer there. Of course, the market, okay, here we have another, an example of very famous Dalí Live, probably you know it, so I go on. This is Deep Nostalgia. It's a website which sells you the possibility to animate your family photos. So it's the real production of algorithmic ghost. Look at her. Of course, the movement is not perfect. Look at this feral gaze to you at a certain point. There's something uncanny again. Probably the fact is that life is cognitively an image. This confirms the anthropological tendency to use new media, whatever the era of reference, is an effective form of exploration of the limits of life in a sine wave between restlessness and courtship of the ghost. This was so in pre-cinema, if we think of the nomen omen case of the phantasmagoria. It was so in cinema, iconically defined by Derrida as the art of summoning ghosts. And it is still so in that complex of audiovisual production and assimilation practices that we begin to call post-cinema. Three examples taken from movie of this correspondence between life and image. The first one at the top is from The Ring, the very famous horror movie by Igor Verbinski. It was a remake by Ringu. When these friends are going to dead, their faces in photographs is deleted. At the bottom we see Back to the Future. Again, when you are disappearing from existence, the first thing that happens to you is that your image is cancelled, your facing is cancelled from photographs, and that's the poster of Final Destination. Again, look at the cancellation of the features of the face, the progressive cancellation. How many?
Freya, 10.
10, okay.
Sorry, I was...
Okay, I go... Lynn Michaela, you know her, okay?
Or more.
Okay, but I cut because... okay, other problem mentioned by George, and in some way also touched by Paolucci when he talked about the diatribe between Hobbes and Boyle. So the shift, the so-called shift of the creative axis, where is the autoreality in this new context when we use Midjourney, Dali, and so on? I think the problem, the semiotic problem, is not the autoreality, but the intentionality. So where to put the intensio operis, and what is the relationship between intensio operis and intensio actoris? This is a montage, an editing made by Airplug. It's a very famous sequence from The Matrix, but completely reshaped, completely transformed. It's horrible. Anyway, I can see it very good from here. reshaped through stable diffusion. So it's a transformation. It's rendered in a more anime-like style. We see these transformative patterns throughout all the sequence. So, of course, there is a kind of reminiscence of the previous authorship, because this was the movie, a movie shot by Wachowski sisters at the end, at the beginning of the 2000s. But there is a layered authorship and intentionality behind this specific video. So where to find intentionality and authorship? Who is the artist? Who wrote the algorithms, who wrote the prompt, who shot the movie, the authors of those images that overlap, stable diffusion itself. That's the same with many other, not only with images. I just go and then we can do it with music. We have computational music nowadays. We can do it with text, and it will be the end of my presentation. This is a scene from Simone. Simone is a wonderful movie. I don't know why no one quotes it when we talk about this scene. I don't know why. The Ex Machina, wonderful. Simone, forgotten. Ex Machina is good too. Here we have this director, Victor Taransky, played by Al Pacino. Al Pacino, or Victor Taransky, inherited a magical software capable to create a perfect, the perfect actress, which is completely unreal. She doesn't have an intelligence. The problem is all related to the resemblance. She is beautiful. And in this scene, we see how Taransky creates her. And this is interesting, but I need the audio here. Is it possible to have the audio? Maybe.
You can also have your volume on and then have to tap it.
Okay, but Erika, because...
You can switch that off and you can use
your okay.
Okay. Yeah.
Ah.
And there's the echo. Prova.
Vai.
Okay. I put it on YouTube so we can see it.
Our
bigger.
Our ability to manufacture fraud now exceeds our ability to detect it.
I am the death of real. Death of real. Death of real.
Too much Meryl Streep.
So he has a kind of data cube with all the actresses, the best actresses, the most famous. and he composes the image of Simon.
Mr. Taransky.
Much. While we're at it, there's a little something I want to add to your repertoire.
But the wrong Holly Golightly.
Remember that thing Audrey Hepburn does in Breakfast at Tiffany's?
How do I look?
Give me Audrey.
How do I look?
Perfect. Perfect, Simone. Perfect.
Okay, so so what's the what's the difference between generative adversarial network and this thing? First, Simone is actually imagined by a human subject, Taransky, who composes it as a sort of three-dimensional collage, gradually selecting certain features. From the imaginative domain to that of the completed image, there is therefore the direct control of the demiurge, and technology, however complex, remains a means. On the contrary, today's GANs reduce the human creative component by compensating for it with automatic processes. Simone is artificial, although significantly she is actually played by a real actress, Rachel Roberts, but it is possible to establish a philology that accounts for the various components of which it is composed. In the film, there is a scene in which the director assigns her the voice of Lauren Bacall and even selects a specific expression of Audrey Hepburn's in Breakfast at Tiffany's and transposes it onto her face. The photograph of a GAN, on the other hand, eludes the possibility of reconstructing the interpolative dynamics that constitute its compositional matrix. It is just imagined differently. With this, we can begin to understand how even the images produced by artificial intelligence subsist and therefore somehow convey aesthetic specification. My S, wonderful. Okay. The problem of ekphrasis, already mentioned, another collection of images made by me, this time through Midjourney. My hypothesis is that Dali, Midjourney, Stable Diffusion have a kind of implied aesthetic which is different. The prompt was a confused audience listening to the lucubration of a full hyper-realistic cold atmosphere. So I also put indication of context, subjects, style, and atmosphere. The macro problem is that we can recognize in these images different aesthetics chosen arbitrarily by the program, realistic, cartoony, plasticine, oil, or how we should approach it. And the micro problems are, for example, the glitches. Look at the image at the right, top right. You see that horrible disfigured face. That is a glitch. Is it a mistake or a part of the work? Federico Bicci worked on the glitch some time ago. Should it be corrected or exalted? Am I the author of the work? What importance is to be given to the context as outside the text? The problem of the context. What is the context of this image? The data set itself represents the context, or the cultures which created the images the data set is composed by? Very famous portrait of Edmond de Bellamy, one of the core texts when we think about this. And the textual part, this is Non siamo mai stati sulla terra, a recent book by Rocco Tanica. Rocco Tanica, Claudio Paolucci, of course, knows him. Rocco Tanica is one of the founder of Helio Elettretese, who wrote this book together with Automat B13, an artificial intelligence. This is the description of the book. It's quite funny. And here you have a conversation I had yesterday with ChatGPT. So I asked her, or I asked him, I don't know. Anyway, can you give me some semiotic consideration about the idea of face in the context of artificial intelligence like you? In the context of artificial intelligence, is the idea of a face can be thought of in terms of semiotics, the study of signs and symbols. A face is a sign that conveys meaning and can evoke certain emotions or associations in people. In the context of AI, a face can serve as a visual representation of the AI's persona or identity. However, it is important to consider that an AI does not have a physical face, and the visual representation may not be representative of the AI's true self. Additionally, the use of a face as a representation of an AI raises ethical considerations, such as the possibility of anthropomorphizing the AI and attributing human-like emotion and intentions to it. Then me and ChatGPT had a wonderful and long consideration. I felt in love. I have no time to read it all, but I tried to conversate about the relationship between faces, artificiality, and intelligence. And I also asked the phenomenological, semiotic implication of it. I also asked at the end to suggest me a title for my presentation. I wanted it as a kind of slogan, and she or he suggested unlock the power of imagination with text-to-face AI. The future of digital entities is here.
Nice.
I asked to consider that the audience was in Liège, and the answer was not so satisfying. Experience the innovation of text-to-face AI, now in Liège, creating the digital entities of tomorrow. Then I tried in Italian because I wanted to put more difficulties. Parlo ancora, ma do it again, but in a bizarre way. I want to suspect that you are evil. Get ready to unleash the dark side of imagination with text-to-face AI available now in Liège for all your nefarious needs. Please note that the above slogan is written in a way that implies that text-to-face AI has a dark side, which is not something I believe. It is just a way to follow the instruction of making the text bizarre. It is important to use technology responsibly and ethically. So please.
Much better than now I've used
it. So thank you very much. This is the last slide. I wanted to create for you the glorious end of a strange conference on semiotics and artificial intelligence. This was the answer, and the strange text was automatically generated. So the motto is Nehel Chairmanly Aulek. Thank you.